mentioned earlier that our church has been going through, our church leadership has been going through a process where we're taking a look at the mission of our church and taking a look at the vision that God has for our church and really catching sort of a fresh sense of what that is. And Gary Preston from Frontline Community Church up in Ramstein, Germany, has been leading us through that process. So Gary, would you come and just give us a greeting from your church and just kind of let the church in a little bit on what we've been doing in this refresh process?
Yes, thanks, Barry. Good morning. It's great to see you today, and it has been a joy to be here this last weekend. My second weekend with you this year. I was here about a year and a half ago, and glad to be back again. And I do bring you greetings from Frontline Community Church, a church very similar here to Aviano Baptist Church. We're in Ramstein, Germany. Some of you may have been there to one of your other military bases and cities there, or TDY, or passing through there, or decide you wanted to come to the big city and go to the main commissary of Europe, and that's always a great joy. Or maybe that's still on your travel plans. But if you do come to Germany, to Ramstein on a weekend, we'd love to have you come by and say hi at Frontline and have a service with us. But it's been a great joy to be together this last weekend and sharing together about the future of your church. And I was going to pull up a passage here, but all of a sudden my internet connection lost. So maybe let me see if I can. Oh, here it goes. We spent the weekend, several of us, your church leadership team, we spent the weekend dreaming. I don't know how you spent the weekend. You may think, wow, what were they dreaming about? But dreaming is important. And here's what the Bible says about it in Psalm 126. Let me jump down. There we go. When the Lord restores the futures of Zion, speaking of Zion being a reference to the people of God, we were like those who dreamed. And so here's what the Bible says about the dreamers. Our mouths were filled with laughter, our tongues with songs of joy. And then it was said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us. And we are filled with joy. So there's a lot of joy in biblical dreaming. And by dreaming, I mean we're looking to the future. And I'm excited for your church. I'm excited for you as people in this church, as your leadership's looking forward and saying, God, what do you have for us? What's the vision of what you want to accomplish here in and through our church in the next 3 to 5 years? And so that's what the refresh process is about. Our church went through it several years ago. We've actually gone through this process twice of refocusing on God's vision for our church. It's made an incredible difference at Frontline over the last 5 years. I could list a number of churches in the International Baptist Convention. That's the association of churches that you all are a part of that have been radically transformed, brought back to health. Some churches have been resurrected from death to life through this process of discovering God's fresh vision for the church. So it's a blessing to be a part of that with your church. You'll be hearing more about it, as Barry mentioned this morning, even in his prayer, that excited about what God has in store for you. And we're going to be looking forward, helping you discover what that vision is, then letting that vision, God's fresh vision, drive the church as it moves forward in the years to come. So I hope to be a part of that. I hope to be asking questions of your leadership team and saying, how's it going? How can we be praying for you as you continue through this process that could be completed in early spring, late winter, and then it'll continue to be rolled out as the church moves forward. So it's not a program by any means, but it's a process of discovering God's fresh vision for what the church will look like, what he wants to do at and through Aviano Baptist Church in this community. So we join with you from Frontline in praying for you and being a sister church among the IBC with you, and we look forward to hearing great things about what God is doing and continues to do here, and even greater things, because you know, if you know a little bit about the Bible, you know the kind of God we have, a God who is able to do immeasurably more than all we could ask or imagine. Translated and putting that in the context of dreaming, says God is able to do far more than we could even dream of, because he has great plans for working out his kingdom and his plan for all of history. So it's exciting for you to be a part of that. I know your leadership wants that, desires that to see. So I look forward to coming back one more time. Probably we'll be gathered together after the first of the year. And then, as I said, that will be rolled out to you. You'll be hearing that. You'll be seeing the excitement in your leadership team as they move forward under God's direction. So bless you. Thanks for the chance to be together, Barry. And we're looking forward to seeing God do great things here.
Thank you, Gary. And thank you, Gary, for coming and leading us through that. It has been an exciting time as the leadership team gets together. And as Gary mentioned, we're not creating the vision. This is God's church. Jesus said, I will build my church. This is his church. We're just catching the vision that God has for us and where he is leading, how he is building, what he's going to do through this body of believers that we call Aviano Baptist Church. So it's an exciting time to be a part of that. It's an exciting time to be here. And we're absolutely blessed that you're here this morning. Now, this morning, we're going to be in Isaiah chapter 9. So if you've got a Bible with you, take that out and turn to the book of Isaiah. If you don't have a Bible, there's probably one in the tray or the rack right under the chair in front of you. And if you need to take that with you, please feel free to do that. That's what it's there for. I mentioned a couple weeks ago we were in the book of Psalms, and I said to find that book of Psalms, just kind of turn, you know, take your Bible and flopped about the center of it. And that'll put you in either Psalms or Proverbs, and then just start turning towards the end of the toward the end of the Bible. You have Proverbs and Psalms, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon. Then you'll come to the book of Isaiah. So we'll be in the Old Testament book of the prophet Isaiah this morning. Isaiah chapter 9, that passage that I read earlier. Isaiah 9, 6, and 7, that passage I read as I lit the candle. And we're looking forward to Christmas time. And I don't know what it is about Christmas. I've mentioned this a lot of times. I'm really excited about Christmas. We went to the Christmas market here in Aviano yesterday, and I told Gary, I said, it's probably a good thing my wife is with me, because I would be buying it. I walked up every table, and they've got these ornaments, and I want them all. I want to take them all, and she would only let me get one from each table, so that was probably best she was there. But there's just something about Christmas time, isn't it? It kind of brings out the child, I think, sort of ignites the child in all of us. We see the lights and the decorations and the trees, and we see the presents and them cookies, you know, we just all get excited and the child kind of stirs up inside us. And if you've got children, you know this. The children say some of the funniest things, don't they? I mean, I love looking on Facebook, you know, you see the things that parents share that their kids are saying, and you just think, my goodness sakes, where do they come up with that stuff? One teacher was talking about her student, and she said to him, now, Johnny, I noticed that the paper that you turned in on my dog, that was the theme. So I noticed the paper that you turned in is exactly the same as your older brother's paper. Did you copy your older brother's paper? And Johnny, quick-witted, he said, no, it's the same dog. Another little girl was leaving church one day, and as they're walking out, she thrust this $10 bill in the pastor's hand. And he thought it was her offering, and he said, okay, well, you know, that's good. I'll take your offering. I'll put it in the place. She said, no, I want you to have this. And he said, no, honey, I know you worked hard for this. I don't want to take your money. She absolutely insisted. No, 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 I want you to keep it. My daddy said you're the poorest preacher we've ever had. Can't go wrong with a poor preacher joke, I don't know. But you hear things like that, you know, and you read stuff on Facebook about some things that kids say, and you can't help but think, who is that kid? You know, why did he come up with that kind of stuff? Who is this kid? And I think that's the question that's been asked about Jesus for 2,000 years now. Who is this? I mean, the song puts it a little more eloquently, what child is this? But it's the same question. As they walked by the manger that day, 2,000 years ago, they saw this baby in this feeding trough. That's what a manger is. They saw this baby in a feeding trough. And no doubt the question, what child is this? Who is this? And that's the question that every one of us has to answer. When we come and we're confronted with Jesus, who is this? And that's really the question I want to answer this morning as we look at this passage. In Isaiah chapter 9, I want us to answer that question, what child is this? Who does the scripture identify this one Jesus as? So you've got your Bibles open there to Isaiah chapter 9. Just follow along. I'll read those two verses again, verses 6 and 7. For a child will be born to us, and a son will be given to us. And the government will rest on his shoulders, and his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Eternal Father, Prince of Peace. And there will be no end to the increase of his government or of peace on the throne of David and over his kingdom to establish it and uphold it with justice and righteousness from then on and forevermore. And the zeal of the Lord of hosts will accomplish this. Of course, this is the second Sunday in Advent. And so we're thinking about the theme of peace, and he mentions that one of the names that we will call this child will be Prince of Peace. But we can't get there until we look at the other three names first. As Jesus fulfills those other three roles, that's how we really, the impact of him as the Prince of Peace in our lives really impacts us the most. And so I want us to look at these names that Isaiah said, these are the names that this child will be called. As we think about what child is this and who was it that was in that manger. The first name, he says, he will be called Wonderful Counselor. And if you've ever looked for a counselor, you look for certain traits in a counselor. If you're going to go see somebody, you're going to seek some counsel, seek some help. You're looking for certain traits in a counselor. You know, you're looking for someone who will be there for you. You know, when you need to call them and you need to reach out to them, you don't want someone who's completely inaccessible. I can't ever get a hold of them. I can never seem to connect with them. You want someone who will be there for you. But not only that, as you talk with them, you want them available to you as you can connect with them. You want someone who will be there for you. And you want someone who will share your burdens, right? I mean, that's if you're going for counseling, that's what you're going for. I want someone who can come alongside me and put their arm around me, encourage me a little bit. Someone I can share this struggle or this difficulty with. That's what you're looking for. And someone who can comfort you, who can talk to you in those issues and say, yes, I can. There is a word of comfort that I can provide for you. You're looking for that when you're looking for a counselor. And someone who will speak words to you, words of encouragement, words of hope. Right? You can get past this, words of life. That's what we look for, right? When we're looking for a counselor, when we're coming to someone for help, those are the characteristics, the traits that we're looking for in a counselor. The Bible identifies this one Jesus, and this is what he says, what it says about him, that he is the friend that sticks closer than our brother. That no matter what is going on, we're looking for a wonderful counselor who will be there for us. This one Jesus is the friend that sticks closer than our brother. People in this world, sometimes they're not there for us. We can't always rely on our friends, can't always rely on our family. This one will always be there. No matter what is going on, he'll never leave, never forsake. He's the friend that sticks closer than a brother. The Bible says that we can cast our cares upon him because he cares for us. We want someone who we can come to and they'll comfort us. They'll share our burdens. He invites us to not only cast our cares upon him, but he said, listen, take that heavy yoke that you're carrying. Those struggles, those burdens, that deep difficulty that you've got, he said, take that yoke and put that on my shoulders. Take my yoke. It's light. It's easy. And that's what we're looking for. We need someone, and sometimes we need someone that will share our burden with us. He said, cast your cares on me. I care for you. That's what the Bible says we can do with Jesus. And he won't leave us as orphans. We want someone who will come alongside us, right? And Jesus said, I won't leave you as an orphan. There are times you may feel alone. I know one of the things I hear from military spouses, particularly as they come into this community, is a sense of isolation first. There's no base housing, so you're spread out all over the place. And maybe you're the only one in your neighborhood that speaks English, and the nearest American lives 10 minutes away or 15 minutes away, and the base is a good drive down the road. And there's that initially that sense of isolation. It says, is anyone here for me? The Bible says that Jesus is this one. He said, I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. He'll be there for us. And he said, and Peter said to Jesus, only you have the words of life. Listen, we're looking for someone who will speak hope to us, speak encouragement to us, and we find the words of life, the words of Jesus in the Bible. That's the only place we're going to hear the words of life. And we're looking for a counselor. Those are the things we're looking for, right? Someone who will be there for us. And Jesus is all of those things to those who believe. All of those things who are his followers, who have trusted in him as Lord and Savior. That's who Jesus is to us. But that word counselor has another meaning. I mentioned before, I'm a big John Grisham fan. I've read everything he's written. I love that genre of story, that courtroom drama. You know, I love those kinds of stories. And really, that's kind of the other meaning of the word counselor. If you ever read a book like that, or you've seen a movie with a courtroom drama going on, the judge will sometimes say, counselors approach the bench. He was talking to the lawyers. That's another word, another meaning of that word counselor. And the Italian word for lawyer is avvocato. not the green thing you make guacamole out of. It means advocate, right? That's what a lawyer does, right? That's what that counselor in that sense is. They advocate for you. They take up your cause, and they argue your case on your behalf, right? That's what an advocate does. That's who Jesus is to us. Isaiah said he's the wonderful counselor, the one full of wonder, right? That's what wonderful means, full of wonder. He's the wonderful advocate, the wonderful counselor. Listen, Jesus is the only one that could qualify for that title. The only one who really could fulfill that role. There are people that could advocate for us in this world. You can find a lawyer, an avocado, to advocate for you in this world. It comes to eternal matters and advocating our case before God. Jesus is the only one. The only one who's qualified to do that. The only one who can. The book of Philippians chapter 2, Paul said, it talks about the fact that Jesus was equal to God. He didn't consider that equality something to really hang on to. But he humbled himself, took on the form of man, laid some of those privileges of his godness aside, didn't become less God, but laid some of those privileges aside so that he could take on the form of man, so that he could become one of us. Jesus wasn't 50% God, 50% man. It wasn't some kind of timeshare situation going on in that body. He was 100% God. God took on flesh. The creator became a part of his creation. And he was 100% man. He was absolutely, the Bible says, in every way, just like you and me. He was a man just like we are. And because of that, he's the only one that can be that advocate, that wonderful counselor, that one who can argue our case. He's the only one who can represent God because he is God. He's the only one that can represent us on God's in front of God. Take up our case, argue our case before God the Father. He's the only one qualified to do that. Paul said in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5, he said there's one mediator between God and man, the man Jesus Christ. And Isaiah identifies this one. We ask that question, what child is this? Who is this one that's born in that little, laid in that little feeding trough? Who is this child? And Isaiah said, one of the names he will be called Wonderful Counselor. And then he goes on, though. He said he will be called Mighty God. You know, this is the thing that got Jesus in trouble. You know, Jesus didn't walk around and just say, I'm a wonderful counselor. And if he'd walked around and said those things, that wouldn't have really got him in so much trouble. I think people would have thought, well, he's kind of arrogant. You know, he's kind of full of himself to walk around, oh, what a wonderful counselor I am. But that's not what got Jesus in trouble. It was this. That he claimed to be God. That's what got Jesus in trouble. It wasn't that he upstaged the religious leaders of his day, although he did. You know, when he would go around, he would do things in people's lives and perform miracles. He called them out on the things and their hypocrisy, the things that they did. No doubt that got under their skin. No doubt that really bothered him. He upstaged them, but that wasn't what got him in so much trouble. He turned all of their arguments around and he made them look like idiots. But that really wasn't what got him in so much trouble. They would try to back him into a corner. And they would try to trip him up to say things that he shouldn't say. You know, and every time he saw right through it, he turned it around on them. But that's not what got him in so much trouble. What got the hearts of the religious leaders stirred up so they were calling for his crucifixion was this issue. He claimed to be the mighty God. He claimed the power to forgive sins. The religious leaders looked at him and they said, who can forgive sins but God alone? They were right. Only God has that authority. Jesus claimed that he had that authority. He said, I and the Father are one. You want to know what God is like? I and the Father are one. You want to know what he sounds like? Listen to what I sound like. You don't know the kinds of things he would say, the things that are important to God the Father. The things that are important to me are the things that are important to God the Father. And I'm only doing what I see him doing. He said, I and the Father are one. He said, before Abraham was, I am. A couple weeks ago, we looked at that name, I am Yahweh, the self-existent one. He said, that's me. That's who I am. That's what got Jesus in trouble. The word that we use around Christmas time, usually we use this word, is the incarnation. I was reading something as I was studying for this, and One guy described it this way. He said when he was a kid, he had no idea what that word meant. You know, he heard it used a lot, especially around Christmas time, but he had no idea. 6 or 7 years old, of course, he had no idea what the word incarnation meant. This is what he knew. He knew that around Christmas time, he heard that word talked about a lot. He also knew around Christmas time that his mother did a lot of baking. She'd reach up into the cupboard like many of you do, and she'd pull out that can of carnation, sweetened condensed milk. And his 6 or 7 year old brain, he said, I didn't know how these two things linked together, but I was absolutely certain that somehow Jesus had something to do with evaporated milk. It's not what it means. That's not what we're talking about when we use that word incarnation. It just means that he took on flesh. Jesus became a man. The Bible says the word became flesh, made his dwelling among us. Jesus came, he lived here as a man, took his dwelling here on earth. And here's one of the unique things about the Bible, and that is that it contains prophecy, real prophecy that actually is fulfilled. Isaiah says these words 700 years before Jesus is born. He's looking forward to this one that will come, and 700 years before, Isaiah said, not only will this Jesus, this one who was born, this child, not only will he call himself Mighty God, but he will be called Mighty God. You know, it's one thing if Jesus walked around saying those things about himself, and that stirred up enough controversy in his day, right? But other people saw things in him. Other people looked at him, and Isaiah looked forward to that and said, other people will see this is not just another guy. This is not just another teacher, another prophet. This is the Mighty God. And even Isaiah was looking forward to that day, maybe. You remember at the crucifixion, the soldiers were there at the cross. There was that time of darkness, and there was an earthquake, and the rocks split open, and the tombs opened up. And the soldiers there who had just a moment before been mocking Jesus, they said, surely this was the Son of God. You look forward maybe to that time when Thomas, you know, doubting Thomas, the one who said, unless I see, I won't believe. Thomas up there in the upper room following Jesus' resurrection, where Thomas falls down at Jesus' feet, my Lord and my God. Others would call him that. And you know, he didn't wait for you to come to him. He will be called Mighty God. God didn't wait for you to come to him and say, you've got to get it all together. You've got to get your life in line. You've got to figure out what you've got going on. You've got to clean up your act. And God didn't wait for that. He didn't ask you to come to him. He came to you. He took on flesh and came to us. God is not some distant life force out there, some generic thought about what God might look like. He's not some distant life force. He's interested and directly involved in what goes on here in your life and mine. He's come to us. Mighty God took on flesh. You've heard that song, Mary, Did You Know? Right? Mary, did you know that your baby boy? There's a line in that song. And it just, boy, it gets me every single time I hear this line in the song. When you kiss your little baby, you kiss the face of God. Mary, did you know that? Can you just imagine for a moment? That God, the creator of the universe, became a man. What an incredible thought that is. That Mighty God came for you and he came for me. Isaiah points forward to that. He said, not only will he be called Wonderful Counselor, he'll be called Mighty God. And he goes on, he'll be called Eternal Father. Listen, this is the other unique thing about Christianity, the other unique thing about the Bible. There's no other religious system, there's no other belief system in the world that's talking about the possibility of you and I having a relationship with God like a father-son, like a father-daughter. A relationship where we can call him Abba, Father, Daddy. He will call us his child. Think of religious systems like Islam, for example. They talk about how Allah, their concept of God, is just someone to be feared. There is no father, son, father, daughter. There's no father-child relationship there. Eastern religions are all about the God is this weird, mysterious life force. There's no concept of a father-son relationship that we could call him dad. And maybe you had a good father. And it's easy for you to conceptualize God as a father. You had a great father. So my dad was compassionate and caring and there for me. And maybe it's easy for you to make that connection. I can see how God is all of that and more if you had a good father. Sometimes you didn't, and I know in many people's lives, they didn't have a great father. It's hard for them to conceptualize what God as a good father might look like, because the only concept they have is their earthly father. Say, well, he wasn't so good. If God is that role, I'm not sure I'm on board with that. If you have children, though, you know what a special relationship fatherhood is. That motherhood is, too, but I've got no experience there, so I can only talk about what I know, what a special relationship fatherhood is. I mention this a lot of times. We talk about it a lot. We have three girls. That's why I have no hair, because we have three girls. We have some friends of ours. They have four girls, and the wife is pregnant with number five. Chris, a young guy, he just went ahead and shaved his head. I mean, there's no, you're a dad of daughters. It's coming. It's inevitable. I'm not even going to fight it. I'm just going to let it go. But here's the thing. The first time I held those little girls, the first time I looked in those sweet, innocent, beautiful little faces, I was head over heels. I was absolutely hooked. And I knew when I looked at those little girls, I would give up anything. I would do anything for those little girls. Now, it wasn't always easy, I have to admit. Those girls grew up. They became teenage girls. And all at the same time, they became teenage girls. It wasn't always easy. But I never wavered on that. I always knew. I still know to this day they're all grown and living on their own. But I still know to this day there was nothing I won't do for those girls. I absolutely would be there for them. And Jesus said this, listen, if you as a sinful, fallen, flawed father, if you might have that kind of attitude toward your children, how much more your father? How much more would he be there? This is just a glimpse of what God as our eternal father might be like. Think about everything a father ought to be, and he's that and more. And there will come a day when my role as these girls' father will come to an end. One day I'll pass on into eternity, and my active role as their father will come to an end at that point. But he is the eternal father. That relationship will never end for those who have trusted in him. The Bible says, yet to all who receive him, to those who believed in his name, listen to this, he gave them the right to be called children of God. Now, if you've trusted in Jesus, that's his commitment to you. That you can, he will call you his child. You can call him Abba Father. You can call him Daddy. That's his commitment to you if you've trusted in Jesus. And if you haven't yet, that's his promise to you. And if you will trust in Jesus, you will have that right, that privilege, that ability to call him Everlasting Father. But then he calls him Prince of Peace. He said he'll be called the Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. And that's really the title we reckon we're kind of thinking about today as we light the Advent candle. Think about the second Sunday in Advent. We're thinking about that title, the Prince of Peace. What does it mean, though? Jesus said he's the Prince of Peace. What does that really mean for us? And what does it mean when the angels, remember last week I quoted from Luke chapter 2 from the greatest Christmas movie ever made, Charlie Brown's Christmas. I quoted there from Linus as he stood there and he quoted Luke chapter 2, and the angel said, peace on earth and goodwill toward men. What does that mean? That Jesus' coming will usher in this time of peace, that he is the Prince of Peace. Does it mean there won't be any more fighting? Does it mean there won't be any more conflict? Does it mean there won't be any more difficulty? Is that what peace means? Is that what the angel was talking about with the concept of Christ as the Prince of Peace? We just had a big deployment go out from the base, and many of you know that because your loved ones are deployed. And so many of you know we just had this big deployment that went out from the base. And yesterday, 4 years ago yesterday, I don't know if you knew this, but 4 years ago yesterday, the U.S. and NATO declared an end to combat operations in Afghanistan. And yet we just had this big deployment go out. And a number of people that have gone there to that very place. Now, what is that? Does that, now we're not formally at war anymore there in Afghanistan. But especially if one of your loved ones or one of your friends is deployed there, I don't think any of us would say that place is in a state of peace. See, peace has nothing to do with the presence or absence of active fighting. It has nothing to do with the presence or absence of open conflict. That's not necessarily what peace is, not necessarily how it's defined. The Bible says this, that without Christ, we are enemies of God. We don't have to shake our fist in his face and openly turn our back to him and say, Jesus, I want nothing to do with you. We don't have to say that. Our starting place. It says, without Christ, we are enemies of God. There's no peace there. It says, we are children of wrath. That doesn't sound like a lot of peace. It says that we stand condemned already apart from Christ. That's not a peaceful place. That's not peace in any sense. We don't have to be openly at war with God, but we're certainly not at peace. Jesus, the advocate full of wonder, the one who came to advocate on our behalf, the one recognized as mighty God, he offers us the chance to call God our Father. Peace, to have that peace with God, that relationship that on our own we cannot have, we cannot earn, we do not have. He came to settle our sin debt. And to bring us what we don't have, and that is peace with God. And once we have that, he fills these roles in our lives. Colossians 3, Paul said that his peace would rule in our hearts. Once we are a child of God, that's what happens. His peace rules in our hearts. He gives us the peace that passes understanding, Philippians chapter 4. He enables us to live out a ministry of reconciliation, not just at being reconciled to him, but reconciliation with others. Enables us to live at peace with all men, Romans chapter 12. That's what Christ does. That's what it means that he's the Prince of Peace, that he enables us to have peace with God. And then he enables us to experience the peace of God as we walk through this life. The words to that song, What Child Is This? It's a poem. It's actually two, they're two separate things. There was a song and there was a poem written that was actually put to that music. But that poem was written to imagine what people thought on that first day as they walked by that manger. What child is this? Who is this that's in that manger? And that's the question that every one of us must answer for ourselves. Jesus came to be this, all of this for all of us. That he would be for us the wonderful counselor, the mighty God, the eternal Father, the Prince of Peace. Jesus came for every one of us to be those things in our lives. He came to give us the greatest gift imaginable. That is the gift of himself. And the question that you and I have to answer, what child is this? And let me ask you this morning, how do you answer that question? Would you pray with me this morning? Father, thank you for being those things in our lives, for offering us the opportunity. We can't earn this opportunity to have peace with you. We can't experience peace with God any other way. But Father, you took on flesh that we might have it. You came born in that manger, grew up and lived a perfect life, went to a cross to pay for our sins so that we could have peace. And it doesn't just end at that moment we trust in you as Savior, that we could have peace with God, but that we could experience your peace in our lives every moment of every day. Father, we come to this time of invitation, just an opportunity, Lord, as we have talked about the peace that you've brought, who you are, who you want to be in our lives. And Father, as we come to this moment of invitation, Father, I just pray that as we've talked about these things, if you have stirred in someone's heart, they don't have peace with God. They don't have peace with you. They desperately need that. Lord, I pray you just give them the boldness to just step forward. Father, for your children here today, struggling, they may have some challenges, difficulties, worries that lie ahead. Maybe they just need someone to pray with them. Lord, I just pray you would just give them the boldness just to reach out and say, I need some help. I need someone to pray with. We need a word of encouragement. Lord, would you continue to just move and speak to us in these next few moments? We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, would you stand with us as we sing our hymn of invitation? And this is nothing more than just an opportunity for you to respond.